Hello, everybody, and welcome to this Law Physics webinar series. So welcome back. And this time we have Daniel Lopez-Fogliani. He is professor in the University of Buenos Aires, also CONICET, and professor in the Pontificia Universidad Católica de Argentina. Here in the past, he did the PhD in the Universidad Autónoma de Madrid, and also he did some postdoc in Sheffield and in Orsay. So the talk of this webinar is going to be very interesting because it's going to be about supersymmetry. And the title of this talk is going to be Reinterpretation of the Higgs Field, New Quarks, and Neutrino Physics in Supersymmetry. So Daniel, if you are ready, you can start your webinar whenever you want.
Okay, thank you very much. Hello to everybody. And let's go to for the transparency, okay? Let's see if this works. Mm-hmm. Okay, can you see the talk now?
Yes, we can see the slides.
Okay, then as you said, the talk is based in reinterpretation of the Higgs fields, new quarks and neutrino physics in supersymmetry. This talk is based in a work in collaboration with Carlos Munoz. This is the archive number. And let's start with the situation in this day. No, there are a lot of people in this day saying that supersymmetry is already dead, or more or less. But this is too much to say. But let's try to understand why we are in this situation with this pessimistic in the community. And then, which was the situation in the 20th century? Let's say at the end of the 20th century. We were completely sure that the neutrinos were massless until 98, when the situation changed and we start to discover that neutrinos were massive. Then a lot of dark matter experiments were running at that time, especially direct detection of dark matter, and people were really very optimistic with this. Dark matter, the idea was that matter will be discovered very soon, and also in experiment of colliders, there were the idea that thanks to missing energy, that was the main point in the simple model of supersymmetry, it will be easy to find supersymmetry. And it was the situation. The situation was a standard model with the spectrum of the standard model, that this one is well known and is the fermion of the standard model. And there were no needs at all for right-handed neutrinos. As I said, at the end of the century, we realized that the neutrino was massive, but the first approach was to say, okay, don't worry about this, because in principle you can give mass to the neutrinos without doing nothing else. And then you could continue working with the standard model as usual. Of course, the standard model has this gauge group apart from the leptons, and you need to add a Higgs boson that introduces in the model the hierarchy problem. But in principle, everything was nice and working very well. For the MCC and the minimal supersymmetric standard model, things were really better because the minimal supersymmetric standard model was correcting the hierarchy problem of the standard model. Thanks to air parity, there was a dark matter candidate. In principle, the neutrino was the candidate that the people like most. And a lot of experiments of direct detection of dark matter were there, and people was expecting to detect this neutralino. And also in colliders, thanks again to the dark matter, because at the end of the cascade, you were obtaining a neutralino that was stable and was a lot of missing energy, and that was easy to be detected. This was the situation. At the beginning of this century, things changed, really, because neutrinos, we know that are not massless, they are massive, and they like to mix a lot together. Of course, you could have a lot of extension of the standard model, where the only thing you do is to do mass, to give mass to the neutrinos, and you can, if you want, make them to mix together and to reproduce experiments. There was no evidence of dark matter, and this was the situation in the 2003, okay? You can see here that the guys were exploring, exploring 10 to the minus 6 picobar. There was also an experiment called Lama that was claiming that the dark matter were there. And people were very optimistic that, okay, in the first decade of the 21st century will appear dark matter. But the situation today is this one. These are the updated constraints from different experiments. And you can see that now we are in, this is 10 to the minus 9 picobar, okay? This was, remember the last plot, you were in 10 to the minus 6, exploring that region. And now you are 10 to the minus 3, 10 to the minus 6, 10 to the minus 9. And we are close to the neutrino background that is going to be very difficult to make experiment there. Not impossible, but difficult to make experiment there. The situation is incredible, incredible in the sense of the experiment. The experiment has improved a lot. And now we have checked all this region. This was a lot of effort for part of the experimentalists. But the situation for the theoretical point of view is a bit depressed because we don't have detected dark matter in the colliders. Appears the Higgs. At the end, the Higgs is there. We complete the standard model point of view. The Higgs is more or less of the order of what you expect in supersymmetry, that is close to the mass of the set, but it's still it's a bit higher for the minimal supersymmetric standard model Higgs. But it's still is consistent with the minimal supersymmetric standard model Higgs. The problem is that the experiments also in collider are putting a lot of constraints, but still these constraints are reasonable. We are talking about TB exclusion limit in supersymmetric particles. And this experiment do not cover all the parameter space. They are for very specific models, for instance, for the constraint minimal supersymmetric standard model. And they are putting constraints, especially there in that specific model, or that specific region of parameter of the minimal supersymmetric standard model. Still, we don't have a lot of luminosity. We need to wait, really, to have better statistics. And the good point is that the U-breaker parity things change a lot. You don't have any more this stable particle giving missing energy. A lot of constraints are weaker. And then the point here is to ask the question, okay, we like minimal models because minimal models give a clear idea of which is the phenomenology you expect, but perhaps we were too much minimal, let's say. We have, because the model we construct perhaps is too minimal. And with this question in mind, let's review which is the situation, what we have. We have, instead of fields, we have superfields, because we are in supersymmetry. Then we have, of course, the gauge group, SU2. Times SU3 times U1. And you have the leptons that now are superfields, and you need to add two Higgses. And this is the simple thing to do, is to have the minimal supersymmetric standard model, is this here, is to say, okay, first we write the complete superpotential, the one that is allowed by gauge symmetries, and you get these two lines here. But the minimum supersymmetric standard model to say, okay, this line is forbidden because of error parity, and you have only this here. Okay, but let's think a bit why we are forbidding the other terms, because this is too much. In principle, the ones that are allowed are all of them. This one, at least this one in red, must be not there because of proton decay. Okay, but only this one in principle. These are these two terms that we don't like it very much, because in principle they are introducing the mu problem. That is, they are terms with dimensions in the superpotential that in principle we understand easy if we say that that is zero or that is a big scale. But when we need this to be ordinary electroweak scale or less, we start to not understand why that is there. Then really, in principle, the simple thing to do, more in the philosophy of supersymmetry, that is, to not have this mu problem, to not have there with dimension of mass, because we don't need it in principle. In principle, the soft terms are the ones that are breaking supersymmetry, and in principle are the only scale you need, the scale of the breaking of supersymmetry. But you need to forbid this, because this one, the one in red, because you don't want to have a proton decay, of course. But you don't need really to impose our parity and to have only the first line. Then the idea is to say, okay, let's do that. Let's put the things that are, in principle, the more natural, more simple. And when we observe is that these are the terms. This has a problem because there is no mass for the Charcino. And this is a problem because this is already excluded. But also there is a symmetry here that is that you see what is in magenta and in blue. You see that you can interchange L and HD, because L and HD has really the same quantum numbers. Under a gauge symmetry, they have the same quantum numbers. Then in principle, you could say, okay, this could be called an L4. This is another super multiples of leptons. This in principle could be done, but you have the problem to what you do with the HU. HU in principle has no interpretation here, but this is something that is allowed because the quantum number of L and HD are the same. Okay. Then if we continue with this philosophy and we say, okay, but wait a minute. We know now that the neutrino has mass, and really we look to the spectrum. We see that looks more symmetric if we include the right-handed neutrino. Then let's include the right-handed neutrino and we solve the mu problem now, because we are going to generate the mu term with the vacuum expansion value of the right-handed neutrino, and then the Charcino are going to be massive, okay? But also we can make the interpretation that what we really have is here a lepton and a right-handed lepton, okay? Now this interpretation is completely allowed. We see the first line here, the lepton of the three families. Oh, these three family lepton are the chiral ones, and you have the right-handed part. And now, adding this right-handed neutrino, this is more symmetric, and really we can make the reinterpretation that the HU is really the right-handed part of a four family of leptons that are vector-like. That is, the right-handed part is also a doublet under SU2, and this looks very symmetric. This is really what we can write. It's exactly the same. We are not doing anything. The only thing we are doing is to reinterpret, make a reinterpretation of things. And then with the reinterpretation of things, the superpotential looks very, very simple. This is the superpotential. But this superpotential is equivalent to the one we wrote before. It's equivalent to the one we proposed in 2006 in Physical Review Letter with Carlos Munoz, that is really is able to say, okay, let's solve the mu problem, including right-handed neutrinos. But also making this, you can make this interpretation, the interpretation that the Higgses are really leptons, okay? Remember this here, it's only this. Then let's talk a bit about the phenomenology of this model, because this changed completely the phenomenology, not the phenomenology of the minimal supersymmetric standard model. First of all, one has mass for the neutrinos. The neutrinos, we know that are massive, they like to mix together, and the mass for the neutrinos goes with the CISO. Here, the only scale is the scale of the supersymmetry breaking. And then because of this, you are obtaining a CISO at electroweak or TV scale. And then this parameter, the Yukawa of the neutrino, must be ordered 10 to the minus 6. 10 to the minus 6 is more or less the same order of the mass of the Yukawa of the electron. And then it looks consistent, looks nice, looks that we are not doing nothing different to the things we already know. It's 10 to the minus 6, similar to Yukawa electron, okay. But there is a surprise here, that is when we calculate the mass of the neutrinos, assuming that everything is diagonal, we do not impose any mixture of the flavor. What you obtain is at the end a mass for the neutrinos that like to mix. It is one. It's off diagonal. even if you are putting diagonal terms here, the Chicago for the neutrinos, you are getting off-diagonal mass matrix. That is, in this model, neutrinos like to mix. And this is what we observe. In principle, there is not a preference on one or another mixture, but they like to mix. They mix, even when you try to not do so. Then this could be also a good point for the model. It's a kind of prediction you are making. Okay. Another thing is that one of the problems in the minimum supersymmetric standard model is that the mass for the Higgs is a bit low. It's at tree level, is below the mass of the set, and that is not really very nice. In this model, thanks to the S neutrino right-handed, the mass of the Higgs at tree level is more, is bigger, and then you don't have really this problem, okay? Then let's continue. Let's continue with what you expect in colliders. In colliders, in principle, you could expect something like this, that is a paper in preparation, that is S neutrinos decaying to photons and could be emission energy. And this could give display vertex, because here air parity is broken, but since you need to reproduce the mass of the neutrinos, remember that the Chicago the neutrino is very small. And that makes a sort of approximate air parity symmetry. And then you can obtain long life objects. That is, you can see display vertex in the collider. Of course, this is complicated to see. These analyses are not easy to make, but this is a possible signature at the colliders. And what about dark matter? Because, one of the fantastic points of the MCCM, air parity conservation, was that you were expecting dark matter to be seen soon. Here, the neutrino cannot be the dark matter because it's decaying. It's another lepton. It's the Higgsino is really, in this interpretation, could be, you can think about it as a lepton with a lot of mass that is a Dirac one. It's a vector-like lepton, okay? It's a vector-like one. Then, you cannot forget that in supersymmetry, you are really working in supergravity, and in supergravity, you have the gravitino. And the gravitino can be a dark matter candidate. Then we have, in the minimal version, we already have a dark matter candidate. And you can, in principle, see this dark matter candidate, and Fermi collaboration, Germán, and all the guys that are there, Lineros, has make analysis taking this into account. And they are exclusions for the dark matter gravitino as dark matter in this model. Okay, we also have some works in this direction, and this is something that is already analyzed and is a possibility to see, because the gravitino can go to a photon and a neutrino. You can see, in principle, a monochromatic photon is the easier thing to see, and you can detect the dark matter has a reasonable mass. Okay, if the gravitino is very, the mass is very small, you are not going to see it, but in principle you don't know the mass of the gravitino. Then this is the idea. In principle, I can stop here and say, okay, you can make the interpretation of the lepton as a four family of leptons, but when you are making that, you see this, you say, okay, come on, but if this is really a lepton, why not to do this? Why not to make this more symmetric to include a vector like quark? And then the picture is very simple. The picture was simple for air parity conservation. That the reason people like very much air parity conservation, because you have particles and super partners, and they don't mix together. Here, everything mixed together, and you a bit lost the idea. What are you doing? Now, with this interpretation, it's easy. What you are doing is always to have leptons and quarks, nothing else. Are leptons and quarks with the super partners. Okay? This is very easy to understand. And if we have add the lepton, why not to add the quarks? And this is the idea now, is to think, okay, what happens if we do so? If we include vector-like quarks, then the superpotential looks in principle a bit complicated. If we take the one as was writing at the beginning, that is continue with the idea that are Higgses, you need to add all these terms here in red, and you get here, you see this is Q and the QC, that is the other, this field here. And this is multiplied by the right-handed is neutrino, no, in the Lagrangian. But that is going to have a vacuum expectation value, and then this is going to be a mass. In principle, if you put here a Chukawa for the one, and this is 1, 10 TV, this is completely safe, but you can expect to see it in the future, in the LAC. Of course, one can simplify this, because if we work in this philosophy, we say, okay, but these are leptons, these are quarks, and we can write this very simple expression. This is, at the end, expression for the superpotential. It's very simple. Okay? Then one can think, okay, it is possible to detect this quark, and the answer is yes, you can detect it. You can detect this in the LAC. You can produce this vector-like quarks, and then this, let's call it a new top and new bottom, okay? That's the reason is here in T, capital T and capital B. And this can decay to the normal standard model particle, that is W and a B, a set and a top, a Higgs and a top, and so on. And this is completely allowed by experiments. It's not excluded, and we could expect to see this in the near future, okay? But really, it's more complicated, the Lagrangian, that what I'm writing here. There are more possibilities. These are the simplest one. We have a work in preparation in this direction. Let's finish with the talk, saying that what we have is a reinterpretation of the Higgs fields, where we can think that it's really four family of leptons, but it's not a normal four family. It's a vector-like four family. This makes a clear idea how to work and what to expect in experiments in this model. And we have asked ourselves, okay, if we are allowing or if vector-like leptons are there, why not a four family of vector-like quarks? And that is what we done. We included, and this is the proposal, no? It's to make this reinterpretation and to be open in mind to find vector-like quarks, because in principle could be there. And okay, thank you very much for be there in the other side of this webcam.
Okay, thank you very much, Daniel. It was a very nice webinar. So now we can, and just to remind to the people that is following this webinar that you can make questions to Daniel via the chat in YouTube or via Twitter if you use you mentioned our Law Physics Twitter account. So if you want to make questions, do it. Meanwhile, we are going to start to the session with the people that is present here in the Hangout. So for the moment, if someone wants to start with a question, please, it's free to do it.
Hi, hello. Can you hear me?
No.
Hi. I'm sorry. Well, my internet is not working well, so I missed part of your talk. So maybe you answered that question. But if may I ask, you said that you have now Dirac-like Higgsinos. Is that right?
So they're vector-like. I didn't hear you properly.
Okay. You, I mean, please? You said that now that you have the symmetry that the Higgsinos are vector-like Dirac particles, so they cannot decay. Is that correct?
No, well, they can decay when you have a parity conservation.
Yes.
Okay. You have the neutrino that is the LSP.
Yeah.
Here, air parity is broken, and since air parity is broken, they are decaying. And what we are saying is that really you can make the reinterpretation that really you don't have the Higgsino down and up. Well, you have really a vector like lepton.
Okay, but it mixes with the Higgsino, with the Buenos, for example, right?
It makes with everything. Okay. Everything that has the same charge, it wants to mix.
Okay.
Makes is mixing with the leptons, it mixing with everything. You need to remember that since you want to reproduce neutrino physics, air parity is broken, but it's a kind of approximate symmetry. Because the Chicago neutrinos are small, are 10 to the minus 6, more or less the same as the Chicago the electron. But that's introduced air parity as an approximate symmetry, and then lepton and Higgsinos or the four family of leptons mixed together, but not a lot.
Okay, so in the fourth family of quarks, they have to mix very little to avoid proton decay, for instance, right?
No, but proton decay we are avoiding because we don't have the lambda 2 prime term.
Ah, okay.
In principle, you can think that the symmetry that is behind this model is a variant reality, okay? Because that symmetry for at the end is forbidden only the lambda 2 primes term. Okay, but it could be another symmetry, not necessarily to be variant reality, but could be variant reality. Variant parity. Variant was called variant reality a long time ago. Variant parity, okay? It's a zeta 3 symmetry. It's a gauge disk symmetry.
That is the model of Reiner et al., right? Yes.
Yes. Okay. The original paper was a paper of Ibanez and Ross, no? And they introduced air parity and these two gauge disk symmetry, the zeta 2 and the zeta 3.
Okay, thank you.
Zeta 2 is air parity, and is that the people like more because forbids a lot of terms, and you have the LSP as stable. But the other possibility, the other gauge disk symmetry compatible with the spectrum of the standard model is this variant parity. It's a zeta 3, see, gauge disk symmetry.
Okay.
I have a question over here. So how does the introduction of these new fields affect unification?
Well, good question. We are not worried about unifications in principle. Of course, you can add more and more vector-like things and have unification. When you introduce the quarks, without introducing the quarks, you have unification because it's the same as in the MCSM, let's say, no?
Right, right.
Because our singlet gauge. Because of singlet gauge, you don't have this problem. But once you introduce the quarks, it's true. You are worried about gauge unification, you are losing this, but you have the possibility to include more and more vector-like quarks as you wish, because vector-like things do not have the problem of introduce gauge anomalies, no?
Yes, but I mean, how does this affect unification? I mean...
No, the coupling are not going to unify if you introduce these vector-like quarks.
Okay, doesn't matter what you do, you don't unify it. Okay.
No, you need to add more vector-like things if you want unification. Or you don't introduce these vector-like quarks, you have unification. You think that you only have a four family for the leptons, but not for the quarks, you can think that you have unification. But remember that you have unification, you need to make some trick at the end, no? That is to think that it's a SU5, and you need to make a redefinition of your gauge couplings, no? You are paying a price always to have unification.
Yeah, for sure.
So, is there another question from the people here in the audience? I'm going to take just fast, very fast in YouTube. No, for the moment, no. But also, I have a couple of questions for you, Daniel. One is usually when people discuss this stuff of proton decay, there is a scale that is very high, 10 to the 15 GeV, the scale for to make the proton very stable. But from here, from where is coming this this scale, because
no, here is everything. You don't need it. You don't need to do so because we are not including the lambda 2 prime term, no? The one that breaks variant number is forbidden. Okay, you are breaking only lepton number, but no variant number if you want.
Okay.
Or the, yes. The lambda 2 prime is zero, okay?
Yeah, but also there are this model in which you can break variant number, but not lepton number. No, I don't know how it's the...
Yeah, but then, no, we don't have that problem because we are forbidden the variant violation term from the beginning. Mm-hmm. One possibility is to think that you have this gauge discrete symmetry that is this variant parity that forbids the variant number violation terms. Also, yeah. Also this is more stable really than the parity because forbids also dangerous terms that are not randomizable, no? This is completely safe.
Okay. So, I mean, related a little bit with this is in the case when you have this new reinterpretation of the quark fields, in the sense of these new vector-like quarks, assuming that maybe in your model also you're going to suppose that gravitin is going to be your dark matter candidate in this new model that you're proposing.
You could add whatever you want, but gravitin is there.
Yeah. The gravitin is going to be there. Since you don't have air parity, is the most likely candidate of your model. But
you know this very well, no?
Yeah. No, but I was wondering which type of new signature, because this new vector quark-like, in principle, gravitino could decay using these new fields.
No, in principle, it's very heavy, no? You are thinking that this vector-like quark is order TV or more. Then it's not a problem for that.
Okay, because you're assuming gravitino lighter.
Yeah, gravitino, you are assuming lighter than that, no?
Mm-hmm.
Lighter than that. Order CV could be, because of the Fermi constraint, but be below, let's say, 10 CV or something like that. But no more than that. Then because it cannot be more than that, you don't need to worry about these new quarks. No?
Mm-hmm. So, but also the one of the stuff that for me was similar, an idea, like not my idea in the sense, the model that introduced these new vector quark likes and tried to reinterpret Higgs with quarks or leptons. Is it possible to explain the number of families that you observe in the standard model, let's say, kind of?
No.
Or you're required to go to kind of discrete symmetries or other type of gauge extractor for that?
I don't think so. In principle, you have the three families for the standard model, like let's say the chiral ones, and you have this vector-like family that is the four family. But you don't have an explanation for that, no?
Mm-hmm.
It's more satisfactory the theoretical point of view because at the end you're working only with leptons and quarks. But you don't have an explanation of why three families, or why this strange family, no, this vector-like family.
Yeah.
But really, this is not the strange one. If you think really the strange are the other one, because the vector-like is the more simple one, no?
Yeah.
The strange are the other ones. This is the easy one.
No, I understand. So, I don't know, this is the question that I have. For my side, I don't know, the people from the Hangout, let me just check in the if we have some questions in Twitter or in YouTube. No, it seems that we don't have, we have many people is saying thank to you, Daniel, and sending hi.
Thank you very much for the invitation.
From the other people, but anyway, if there is more questions, this is the moment to do it. Otherwise, we can, first of all, thanks Daniel because of this very interesting webinar and the model is very, very nice, very appealing. So, and also to tell to the people that is following the webinar and or people that is watching this webinar via our YouTube channel that you can subscribe to the channel and to get the notification each time that we have a new webinar. And of course, you can visit our WordPress page, it's lawphysics.wordpress.com. And of course, we can see again in the next time for a new webinar of this law physics webinar series. That is going to be Professor Enrico Nardi from Frascati University. So, since we don't have anything else to say, so we can see you next time. See you, and thank you, Daniel, for everything.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.